God loves everyone so much, and is always there for you no matter what. We also learned that with God, that God is always with us, whether you're happy, sad, scared, or excited. God is right there by your side. Isn't that comforting to know that one who made the whole universe is also our best friend? I want you to remember how awesome God is. God is big enough to create the entire universe, close enough to hear our prayers. God's love for us is never ending, and that's something we can always share, celebrate. But before I share that special news, let's pray. Everyone bow your heads, close your eyes. Dear God, thank you for your incredible love. Thank you for creating this awesome and wonderful world and for being our friend.
Amen.
Help us to always remember how awesome you are and to trust in you every day. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, for the news. You guys ready? Okay, so I received a letter the other day. And so I'm going to be exploring the galaxy and also planet Earth in search for more awesome things that God has created and done. But here's the best part. Ready? You guys ready? I was given a sidekick to come along. And so I want everyone to come and I'm going to introduce my special friend, Cadet Titus. What's up, bud? Come here, Titus.
Come here.
Come here, Titus. Come here, bud. I got your speech treats. Let's go.
Look at this guy.
All right. So starting from tomorrow, Titus and I will be off exploring. Right? The galaxy and whatever God has planned for us. So I thank you everyone for listening to us, and I hope you guys have a great, great day.
Yay!
I hear the roaring thunder.
Works in sales, and if your numbers don't add up, you're going to be in trouble, aren't you?
Miss Julia, I'll bet you if your numbers don't add up, you're really going to be in trouble. All right? So, Miss Alicia, if she messes up the numbers on medicine, it can mean you hurting or not feeling nothing for a long time. Right? She has to make her numbers matter for the medicine that she gives people. Well, the thing that I love about the band is the numbers don't lie. When we participate or when we don't participate, it just is what it is. There's no gray areas. All right, let's go to the next thing. Accountability is a gift. And I think for a long time we've gone to church and we've been like, oh my word, these people are going to judge me. What are they going to think about my face? What are they going to think about my family? What are they going to think about my kids screaming? What are they going to think? You know, we are prone to worry. But we're here as accountability partners to hold each other's arms up, not to beat each other over the head. Okay? Next thing. Non-participation doesn't mean wicked and ungodly. It means MIA. What does MIA mean?
Missing in action.
Missing in action. Wilson, can you help me out? Okay. I asked Wilson to come help me out while we finish the round. Choose somebody.
Who can I pick on? Okay.
Hurry.
Josh.
Josh. This is your lucky day, friend. This is your lucky day.
You might want to put it down.
Oh, yeah. Focus.
All right, go ahead.
Remember, I'm greater than you still. Just remember that.
All right.
Okay, so, don't worry, we're not going to be having any, we're not going to have any senseless bludgeoning today. So, I made this sword a couple, good while back, and I think I have a good purpose for it right now. But anyway, so, Josh, I would like you to take the sword, hold it, put one hand behind your back. I want you to hold it like this, without letting it lean up against your lip, rest like that.
Okay.
Punch straight out, as long as you can.
Like this?
Okay. Straight. All right, now while he's doing that, we're going to talk for a few minutes. Okay? Mission in action means, we're going to see if Josh needs to get it like this. All right, mission in action means they're not here. All right? So, if you're an adult and you're on the band, and you're on there and you're like, man, he didn't check. What does she think? What do you mean they liked it? I hate the like emoji. Like, I don't say likes. Like is so not personal. But Jonathan's not here, but Jonathan Langley loves like buttons. It is his favorite emoji of the whole world, okay? But Satan puts things in our minds and they go, what did he mean by that? Or what were they thinking? Well, they're probably actually not even thinking about you. But what we can learn from being MIA is life is hard. You can go to the next slide here. Life is hard. The band is a way that we can be load lighteners. Okay? Josh, how's your sword doing, buddy?
It's going fantastic.
How's it feel?
It's feeling all right. Just my arm just getting a little tingly.
Life is like that sometimes, isn't it?
I don't think
it hits you hard in between. And we come here on Sundays and Wednesdays and we worship together in spirit and truth because God's called us to come together, right? The band is not magical. But the band does something for us in ways that maybe you don't need it, but maybe somebody else. You know, Josh, that sword is not bothering me one iota. If he holds it, great. If he doesn't, oh well. But right now, Josh has a burden. He's managing all right. He's faking that smile. Y'all see that smile? All right? But watch this. Judd, come put two fingers on one side.
Thank you, good sir.
Put two fingers on the other side. Rachel, come put two fingers on the other side. Josh, how are you feeling?
My side.
Yeah.
The first one, I heard you say, thank you, good sir. So that one really made a difference. But now you're just holding a little piece of the puzzle. And that's what we do as a family. Now, whether that's on the band or whether that's in real life, no one should go from Sunday to Sunday and not know what's going on in their church family. All right? We are connected. We are a body. And as our Sunday school is for Josh, we're better together. All right? Okay. You can put that down. And let's go to the points. Josh is like, woohoo! Oh, yes, yes. Okay, I'll tell you what this one is. Josh, you can agree with this. How does the band make a difference? Communicates, I care.
Yeah, she was just saying you'll agree with this.
It says, I'm present. I'm here. Sometimes people just need to know you're there. It says, my church family matters. You know, one of the reasons people are MIA is because they're too busy. Did you know that? And do you ever feel like you're just strung out? I have felt like I've been strung out even this past week. I don't need somebody to come over and say, you are too busy, because what I really want to say is, duh, right? I mean, there are times that we go through that it's just busy. What if we just care for one another? What if we just said, I know you've been quiet. Can I help you? I know you're hurting. Can I be there? Can I pray with you? Maybe, listen, food works. Find out what their favorite meal is. Last week, I took a gamble, and I messaged somebody on their anniversary, and I said, I know you normally always go out to eat, and you can't. Would you give me your food order and let us get you something? They said yes. First time ever. Just take a chance on people. Take a chance on them when they're mean. Take a chance on them when they're quiet. When they respond, when they don't. But listen, we can just be here for each other. The last thing it says is, I'm willing to share my courage to encourage others. Josh was about to drop that sword at some point. If we let him hang there until 9 o'clock tonight, the old boy would be tired. Right? He's worked all day. He's got baggage that nobody knows about. He might have a grumpy farmer today. And he barely made it to church on Wednesday night, and I asked him to hold the sword. He's probably like, have you lost your mind? Right? Sometimes those things hit us, but when we come along one another and say, I'll give you two fingers, I'll give you a hand, I'll give you a smile or an encouragement. And sometimes that's all you have, but you know what? If you give God less than you have, do you know what he does? Fills you back up. And I really can't explain that. But I think all of you know that I'm telling the truth. All right. Let's look at our points. All right. Here we have the winners. We got three groups. We've got kids. We've got most improved and the most overall. So the kids, drum roll, and if they had a question, they would blow I'm serious. I want you to know something. That's a real disciple. It's somebody with a heart that panteth for water, running after Jesus. Yes, it was just a man challenge, but it really meant a lot to me. Miss Jodella, you're going to be our most improved because you started out getting your mama to do your post, but all of a sudden we saw your name up there. And you didn't have to do that. A lot of ladies your age cannot do that. But you tried, and you're trying, and I love that. And then your mama, I can't explain to you what you've done by her. Just the way that you have pushed your fellow. And you have been on Nelson like white on rice.
She'll come back to Earth after she's done exploring with Titus. So. That was the cutest thing I ever saw. But anyway, oh, I love that. All right, well, let's look at Ephesians chapter 5. And I'm gonna end this with a bang here. I actually put some effort into the work. Put it back. All right, I'm not ready for that yet. All right. All right, so let's look at Ephesians chapter 5, and we're going to look at let's just go ahead and go to verse 1 here. Wait a minute. I'm sorry, guys. Let's look at verse 15. So, actually, you know, let's go back to 14, because this is really important. And I know that this is kind of referring to lost people, but at the same time, it's time for Christians to wake up too, don't you think?
Mm-hmm.
And so let's look at what it says in verse 14. Wherefore he said, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. And then he gives some instructions here. He says, see then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. Have you ever seen a squirrel when he goes across a power line? Things are amazing. They do this tightrope walk, you know, right across the power line. That's walking with circumspectness, all right? He's walking circumspectly across that power line. He's walking with balance, all right? He makes sure that everything that he does, we have a walk, and we walk with balance, all right? Now, this is the key right here, redeeming the time. Because the days are evil, wherefore be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. You say, well, what is the will of the Lord? I don't understand. I feel like the Bible keeps telling me what the will of the Lord is, but I've never been able to figure out what the will of the Lord is in my life. Well, here's the question that you need to ask. If God's not showing you what his plan is for you, then you need to ask yourself, am I doing his will right now in the little things? The little areas where nobody else is looking. In the prayer closet. Involvement. You know, God says, Jesus says, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another. And I'm not saying that the band is necessarily a something, but what Marianne said was very important. It's a way of showing that you love one another. You know, when we put something on there, like for example, you know, you heard about Miss Jodella's daughter passing, and when you see it and you don't say anything, it's important that we say something, that we come to our sister and say, we're praying for you. And I really appreciate all the comments that were put up there. But the band is not scriptural, but the band is an opportunity to live out scripture, to show some love. It's an easy way to show love. It really is. So, you know, these are some things to consider. But it's important to understand what the will of the Lord is. Now, we're actually looking specifically at work, all right? Now, I know that the young people don't necessarily have jobs, but you will, all right? You will have jobs, and this is very important for the young people. I think Wilson's beginning to figure this out as he's going into college and you're having to juggle things. And, you know, there are lots of different people who have different situations in their job. There are some people who are absolutely put out and ready to stop working. My dad had a job. He put his whole life into Bilo. He drove for CNS Distributors, which actually was Ahold. And then Ahold sold their company to CNS Distributors. And as soon as they did, they began to... Dad was getting paid a lot. He was an older guy. And for 20 years, he had worked for them. And they began to increase his load and to make him tired. They made him so tired that he ended up leaving his truck at the checkpoint and going home, and they called him up and said, you know, you left your truck on right there at the checkpoint. And eventually they let him go, and they took his retirement. What a horrible thing. And he's driving now. That's an unfortunate thing, but he put his life into that. There are some people who they live for the very next success story in their life. They want that next promotion. They want to see something different happen in their life. They're devoted to their job. They've got that drive to see the next success story, the next promotion. There's nothing wrong with work. God called us to work. I mean, since the fall of man, God has called us to work. Now, he did tell us to work before the fall. But it is necessary that a man work, and the Bible says if he doesn't work, he shouldn't eat either. I'm for the Bible. I'm not for all this government stuff. I think that the Bible is, that's the key. That's the answer. But now there are three different. Now you can open it up, Harrison. There are three different domains that we live in. This is our circumspect walk. All right. Now I'll tell you when to change it. Okay. But there is the social, all right, there actually the work, all right, we have work. No, I didn't say do it, all right, go back. pardon me, all right, so, all right, I'm gonna tell you when, all right, is that clear? All right, so, we have three different ones, all right, we have work, we have social domain, and we have the spiritual domain. They all are in our time agenda, all right? They all fit into our time agenda. It's necessary that we understand that there's a limited amount of time to devote to these domains. There's 24 hours a day, 7 days in a week, 30 days in a month, and 365 days in a year. So if one activity expands over a duration of time, you've actually contracted the others in order to do so. Right now, almost no one says that work is a greater priority than family. How many of you believe that family is more important than work? Of course we do, all of us, all of us. That's not the point, that's not what's happening. You know, here's the thing. Here's what some of us might have possibly done, you know, or might would do if there is other people that we know. If they held their hand up and said that family is more of a priority than work, and we look over and we go, he thinks that family is priority? he's married to work, all right? But the fact is he does believe, or she does believe, that family is priority. But there's a problem, all right? Almost no one says that work is a greater priority than family. So I'm going to put my family lower on my list. No, it's just that the demands of your job gobble up the time that you could be spending with your family, all right? Now, this is what I mean, all right? Go ahead, Harrison. The more you expand work, the more you expand your time at work, your devotion to work, right? You're not intentionally trying to get rid of your time with your family and with your church. However, because you're expanding work, it's taking away time for other things like spirituality, your time with God, your time at church. There's a lot of people who are so devoted to work that they have left our church and have never come back. There was a man who he was absolutely in love with God. He came here, got saved under the preaching of Will Rice, and he was talking about, he was practically singing a hymn in the hymn book. He didn't even realize it. He said, Pastor, ever since I got saved, everything's greener, everything's bluer, the birds sing much sweeter. And he didn't realize it, but he was singing Loved with Everlasting Love in the hymn book, all right? I am his and he is mine. Heaven around is softer blue, heaven above is softer blue, earth around is sweeter green. Something lives in every hue, Christless eyes have never seen. And then he came to me and he said, Pastor, I need a job and I'd like to pray with you that the Lord will give me a job. I have faith that he'll give it to me. I'd like for you to teach me how to pray at the same time. And so we began to pray for a job. And guess what? I told him, I gave him the warning. I said, now listen. I said, you're going to be tempted to check the box that says, I will work on Sunday. I said, now the Lord gave you that job. And so you have to make sure that you give God his Sunday and honor him and know, just like the Sabbath, know that he's going to take care of you. And he said, yeah, I'll do that. And so he comes and he gets that application and he starts thinking, boy, I need that money. I need that job. I need that work. And he goes and he checks off Sunday. And we never saw him after that. He never came back to church. He was growing. He was doing great things. Do you think he said, I don't want to have anything to do with God? No, I think he owed everything to God. I think he realized, you know what, if it wasn't for God, I wouldn't have this job. But the point is he began to expand the importance of his work, and everything else, the time-wise, began to shrink. So we have to be very careful, all right? Now, Harrison, go ahead and go off of that, okay? It's because we don't have limitless time. That's ultimately the thing. I was talking with Judson. This morning, and we were talking about the four different dimensions, length, width, height, and time. And Judson was in awe. You know, we're talking about awesome. I said, God is in the fifth dimension. He's outside of time. And it was just something incredible to him to think about. But Elijah, Enoch, they haven't changed. Their age hasn't changed because they're outside of time, even though here, we're thinking they're thousands of years old. They haven't changed because they're outside of time. A few people would say their God, their their God time is less important. Wouldn't you say? Wouldn't you say God time is number one? Right? How many of you believe that? Okay? It's important that our God time is number one. But the amount of time they put into their workload eats away at their time for God and church attendance. And it's important. Now I realize that some of you have to go to work. You have your schedules. I understand that. That's not exactly what I'm talking about. But what I am saying is you make it a point at every opportunity that you can, those of you who can't come to church, that you're here when the doors are open, if you're able. But it's impossible for one area of our calling to expand and for nothing to happen with those other equally important callings to contract. They have to contract. There's no way, because we're inside of time. And it's necessary that we maintain a balance. Everything is spiritual. But ultimately, we need to balance out our spiritual time. And don't you think that if we expanded our spiritual time that and everything else began to shrink, that we would look spiritual, but we really probably wouldn't be very godly, would we? I've known many people who live like monks, but they're practically worthless to society. But then you've got other people who they devote too much time to social stuff, and they don't work, right? They don't work, and they don't spend much time spiritually. That would be, I guess you could call the Irish and the pubs, all right? They blow up social time, social hour, all right? And so, you know, you have to maintain a balance to these things, all right? So don't ask what your priorities are so much as if your work has expanded to the point where all other callings have contracted to the point they are completely diminished. All right, so now the second thing I want to look at is listing your priorities doesn't give it causality. All right? Now, what does that mean, okay? All right, I'm going to be honest with you. My ADD is killing me today. I'm sorry. It's not, I'm normally not fussy. I'm sorry. anyway, all right. I'm sorry. My brain just going everywhere. But anyway, all right. So listing your priorities doesn't give it causality. All right. So why are so many of us closet workaholics? All right. Why are so many of us closet workaholics? Why are we working so much to the detriment of family and church and at their expense? All right. See, the thing about it is we have a tendency to work too hard. We have a tendency to devote our time. Why is it that this happens, all right? Is it because we don't love our family? Is it because we don't want to be with them? Is it because we would rather not be with God? No, that's not true. But why is it? Why do so many people walk around with marital and parental guilt? Why are so many people having such a hard time putting work in its proper God-designed place? Workaholics don't have a priority or a schedule problem. Say it with me, okay? They have a what? They have an awe problem, all right? They have an awe problem. We've been saying this all summer, okay? They have an awe problem, which results in a detrimentally relational and spiritual scheduling problem, all right? Because they've lost an awe of their God. They've lost that, they've gotten their eyes off of God, and they're saying basically, They get their eyes off of something else. Sit still, guys. All right? Sit still. All right. This results in a mess with scheduling. All right? Good theology doesn't just define who God is. It also defines us as his children. All right? It defines us as his children. It's not just that God is awesome in glory, but that he is all he is for you by grace. All right? Now, God's awesome glory has been showered down on me and you by grace. He is awesome in power for us, right? He's awesome in sovereignty for us. He's awesome in mercy for us. He's awesome in wisdom for us. He's awesome in love for us, in holiness for us. He's awesome in patience for us. He's awesome in faithfulness for us. He's awesome in grace for us. What he is for us. Who he is for us. I'm going to say it differently so that you don't miss it, okay? God is I am for what I need. God is I am for what you need. God is I am for what we need. Why do you think that's the name he wanted Moses to give Israel? Think about it, all right? It's important that we think about this. How many times did they get distracted and drawn to the wrong thing on their wilderness journey? And I'm going to tell you, he said, I know this is going to happen. They need to learn that all they need is the great I am for who they are and what they are. I'm going to be that for them. I do not have to look elsewhere for the spiritual resources necessary for living, for meaning and purpose for my life, to define who I am, to measure my potential, to find that inner sense of peace and well-being, because I have God there with me. He's my I am, because he is all of those things. Let me say it to you in the person of God. I am all of those things for you. That's a blessing. To those that are hungry, he said, I am the bread of life. To those who said that they're thirsty, he said, I am the living water. And to those who are lost, he said, I am the way. And to those who are living a lie, he said, I am the truth. And to those who are at a dead end, he said, I am the door. And to those who are forsaken, he said, I am the good shepherd. And praise God, even after death, he still is what we need for us, because he said, I am the resurrection. He is, even after we're gone. He's everything that we need. He is who he is for me. But if you get distracted by the needs of this world, you will search for what is already available to you elsewhere, and then you'll never find it. Because you don't want to get distracted from him, from the all you need. If we were made by him and for him, and if the Father is not of the world, and we were made for him, what makes you think that you're going to find what you need apart from him? What makes you think that your work is going to satisfy you? I've known men who are successful millionaires, and they have gotten to the end of their life, and they absolutely loathe their job. It's important that we understand we were made for him, and he is not of this world. I like the song, Jesus is all the world to me, but I hate to say it, but my Father is not of this world. He is my world. It's necessary that we look at it that way. Because work is such a huge identity in our lives, if we're not careful, we'll let it consume us and leave all those who need us behind. And who we'd never turn on or claim to be lost in our lives, we end up starving for our attention. They need us. Look, I'm going to tell you something. Our families need us. Dads, our families need us. You know, it's necessary that we take time for our families, for our church, for our God, and for work. All of these things balance out. God expects us to work, but we can't expand one thing because everything else is going to contract. If you look to work for your identity, you'll find it hard to resist its demands, its risks, and challenges of reward. So I want to look at the horizontal identities of work really quick, okay? I know I'm going a little bit over time here, okay? But the horizontal identities of work, first of all, achievement and success. Achievement and success. All right, if you're going to identify with work, all right, who should we identify with? We should identify with God, right? I'm a branch of the true vine. I am a friend of God. I am the salt of the earth. I'm the light of the world. These things that are found in the Word of God. But if we identify with work, it's possible that we may identify with, that an identity could be achievement or success. I am what I have accomplished. Success makes you feel able and confident. It does, doesn't it? I mean, it does feel good. There's nothing wrong with success. A trail of successes makes you feel like the big man. And none of this is inherently bad, but when you look at it for your personal savior, what you seek for in life, it's very hard to harness your drive for it. After a while, success will change from something you enjoyed to something you absolutely despise. It's practically like smoking and drinking, isn't it? I don't know why I'm so addicted to this job. I don't know why I keep wearing myself out. When I first started here as a pastor, I would wear myself out, and we would have church, and we would do stuff. I mean, like, I actually made a fancy PowerPoint today. But in the past, I used to make the craziest, wildest, phenomenal PowerPoints. And when I'd be done with each service, I'd be like, why do I put so much time into these things? It's because I was expanding what it was my drive. I wanted things to be better. I wanted to impress. I wanted to grow the church. That's just not how it works. It's like smoking. It's like an addiction. It's workaholism. Because you still invest everything for that next success story. Only when you keep your focus on God Himself as your all will you keep success in its proper place. Another identity with work could be power or control. I am in control and therefore I am. You know, there are some of us that are control freaks, all right? In a world that is so out of control, the idea of being in control can dominate our life. I want you to think about that. In a world that is so out of control, look, I'm going to tell you something. Every time I see the political mess that's on the TV, I'm like, this world is out of control. And I have a desire to want to be in control a little bit more. If you're not sure what I mean as far as wanting to be in control, try teaching a child to drive. What I mean by that, all right. What I mean is, when you got this kid who's in control, he's got the gas, he's got the brake, he's got the steering wheel, and you're sitting there in the passenger side, let's see how you act when they're about to run into a ditch. Okay? Brake! All right? Stop! All right? Judge, I do a good job, don't I? Pretty good. All right. I always say, the thing that contents me, that makes me happy when I'm trying to teach Judd how to drive, I said, the thing that contents me is that you realize you could go into the ditch too. I said, the moment you don't think you could go into the ditch, I'm going to be worried. All right? But it's important that we recognize that there is a problem of wanting to be in control. A controlling mother or father will make their family feel used or never reaching the parent's standards. I just feel like I can't ever make her happy. I feel like I can't ever make him happy. A controlling wife will weary of her husband's domineering attitude. A controlling husband will weary his wife's his wife with his domineering attitude. It's the same thing with siblings, your brothers and your sisters. If you're trying to be the boss of your brothers and sisters, they're going to get tired of you. It's necessary that we recognize who is in control. And he's Jesus. He that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall have all those who think they're in control in derision. Number three, another identity of work could be prosperity or possessions. I am the pile of stuff that I accumulated. That's what I mean by that, all right? It's a dangerous place to look for identity. A nice house, luxury cars, a four-wheeler, two gators, all right? I would love to have a gator, but those things are expensive, all right? Yeah, what's a gator, all right? How do you explain what it is? I can't explain it.
Oh, it's just a little utility vehicle.
Yeah, it's almost like a tractor / four-wheeler / truck.
I need you one.
Yeah, I'll take it. But our clothes, I was just talking to a guy not too long ago. I said, how many shoes you got? He says, I lost count. And the reason, not just junk shoes, expensive shoes. It's all media driven. The media thrives on appearances, the icon of success, and our awe of God helps us to realize He is the provider of all that we need. But when we take our awe off of Him, suddenly possessions become something that we need more and more to satisfy us. Some of us can't live. If our cabinets are empty, if we don't have any food, we panic. Why? It's because we've gotten our awe of the one who can provide. So let's just consider these things. And I realize it's 7:51. We're supposed to be done with all of that. We're going to give you the questions today to take home. And you really should consider some of these questions that are on here and maybe just, expand a little spiritual time, all right? And just see what God does with these questions. I think they'll really help you. I'm going to tell you, I'll be the first to tell you that this last study helped me immensely. And if you're curious about the book that this was based on, it's called Law, I think. Yeah, and so I can share the book with you, but it's super good. I wouldn't get it on Audible, but I would read the book though. I would get the book, but anyway. All right, so let's pray, okay? Thank you so much for listening. And we have you can go ahead and switch to the, we got Star Crunch again, okay? All right, so let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this time we can be together. And Lord, we pray that you would just help us as we conclude this morning.